से समरकंद और फिर मॉस्को, मॉस्को से जर्मनी होते हुए वो जापान गए, और कैसी कैसी विषम परिस्थितियों में उन्होंने यात्रा की। और इसके बाद सबसे जो महत्वपूर्ण बात मुझे लगती है कि जापान और जर्मनी जैसे देश जहाँ की भाषा बिल्कुल दूसरी है, कम्युनिकेट करना बहुत मुश्किल है, वहाँ जा करके लोगों को एकत्रित करके एक ऐसी फौज तैयार करना जो भारत की आज़ादी के लिए वो अंग्रेजों से मुकाबला करे और लोगों को प्रेरित करना, ये अपने आप में एक ऐसा उदाहरण है जो शायद इतिहास में कहीं नहीं मिलता है। तो मुझे लगता है कि नेताजी का जो ये व्यक्तित्व है, जो पिछले 70-75 सालों से आज़ादी के बाद हमें कभी इस तरह से देखने को नहीं मिला, और जो वर्तमान समय में अभी सरकार ने जो निर्णय लिया है कि इस दिवस को हम पराक्रम दिवस के रूप में मनाएंगे, और इस 125वीं सालगिरह के अवसर पे एक पूरे वर्ष भर कुछ कार्यक्रम चलेंगे, तो मैं उम्मीद करता हूं कि ये जो पूरा वर्ष भर का कार्यक्रम है, नेताजी के जीवन को, उनके योगदान को भारत के परिप्रेक्ष्य में समझने का एक बहुत बड़ा अवसर होगा। मेरी तो एनसीईआरटी के निदेशक महोदय से अनुरोध होगा कि ये आज के इस कार्यक्रम पे हम विराम न डालें, हम इसमें आगे भी कुछ ऐसा कार्यक्रम करें जिससे कि एनसीईआरटी के माध्यम से भी लोगों को नेताजी के बारे में जानकारी का अवसर मिले। तो मैं बहुत ज़्यादा समय नहीं लूंगा, इस कार्यक्रम की औपचारिक शुरुआत करने के लिए मैं अनुरोध करूंगा, सभी हमारे गेस्ट आ चुके हैं। आज हमारे जो दो प्रमुख वक्ता हैं वो हैं प्रोफेसर प्रियदर्शी मुखर्जी जो जवाहरलाल नेहरू यूनिवर्सिटी से हैं, और दूसरे वक्ता हैं डॉक्टर विथिन ठाकुर, ये सेंट्रल यूनिवर्सिटी तमिलनाडु से हैं। इनका विस्तृत परिचय जब इनके बोलने का वक्त आएगा तब मैं दूंगा। तो इस कार्यक्रम की शुरुआत करने में सबसे पहले मैं इस कक्ष में उपस्थित हमारे निदेशक महोदय प्रोफेसर श्रीधर श्रीवास्तव जी, सेक्रेटरी मेजर हर्ष कुमार जी और डीन कोऑर्डिनेशन गौरी श्रीवास्तव जी से अनुरोध करूंगा कि सर्वप्रथम नेताजी के फोटोग्राफ पे माल्यार्पण करें और उन्हें श्रद्धांजलि अर्पित करें, श्रद्धा सुमन अर्पित करें। अब मैं जैसा कि शुरू में बताया गया कि मैंने बताया कि आज का जो ये कार्यक्रम है वो प्रमुख रूप से दो वक्ता जिन्होंने नेताजी सुभाष चंद्र बोस के जीवन पे बहुत ज़्यादा कार्य किया है, उन पे बहुत ज़्यादा लिखा है, हम उनको सुनेंगे। लेकिन उसके पूर्व मैं अनुरोध करूँगा प्रोफेसर गौरी श्रीवास्तव, डीन कोऑर्डिनेशन एंड हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सोशल साइंस एंड ह्यूमैनिटीज से, कि वो सभी डायरेक्टर एनसीईआरटी, सेक्रेटरी और दोनों स्पीकर का स्वागत करें और नेताजी के बारे में अपने विचार रखें ब्रीफ में।
धन्यवाद दिनेश जी। मैं आपका निदेशक महोदय, सेक्रेटरी दिनेश जी, जो इस प्रोग्राम के कोऑर्डिनेटर हैं और जितने भी हमारे कलीग्स हैं जो इस प्रोग्राम को वर्चुअल मोड से देख रहे हैं, आप सबका स्वागत करती हूँ। आज का दिन हम सबके लिए बहुत प्रेरणादायक है, क्योंकि आज हम लोग नेताजी सुभाष चंद्र बोस को उनकी 125th बर्थ एनिवर्सरी को सेलिब्रेट कर रहे हैं। और मेरा भी बड़ा सौभाग्य है कि मैं एक इतिहास के छात्र के नाते मैं जब भी इतिहास के पन्ने को पलटती हूँ, मुझे हमेशा ये रहता है कि मेरे शोध कार्य अभी खत्म नहीं हुआ है, वो पूरे जीवन तक चलता रहेगा जब तक मैं स्वस्थ हूँ। मैंने काफ़ी काम किया था अभी थोड़े साल पहले 1942 क्विट इंडिया मूवमेंट पे। मैं इसको आपके सामने इसलिए रख रही हूँ क्योंकि जब मैंने एक आर्काइव्स और कई फील्ड वर्क भी किया तो मुझे कई ऐसे लोग मिले जिन्होंने इस आंदोलन में भाग लिया। और जब मैंने एक एल्बम छोटी सी बनाई और मैंने नेशनल आर्काइव से सुभाष चंद्र बोस के कुछ प्राइवेट पेपर्स कंसल्ट किए तो मुझे उनके रानी ऑफ झांसी रेजिमेंट के बारे में कुछ कागज़ और कुछ तस्वीर मिली जिसको मैंने एल्बम में शामिल किया। आज मैं बड़े गर्व से कहना चाहूँगी कि एक रेजिमेंट जो विमेन और ये टोटली विमेन मैन और द लीडर ऑफ द रेजिमेंट वॉज अ वुमन, तो हमारी महिलाएं पीछे नहीं थी। इस नेताजी सुभाष चंद्र बोस को काफ़ी विश्वास था हमारी विमेन पे। और जब मैंने तस्वीर लगाई तो मैंने लेख नहीं लिखा, लेकिन कुछ दो तीन दिन पहले जब हमने क्विज आइटम बनाया तो मैंने एक किताब मेरे सामने आई जहाँ पे मैंने ऐसी कुछ चीज़ें पढ़ी जो मुझे बहुत प्रेरणादायक लगी और मैं सोचती हूँ मैं आपसे इसको ज़रूर शेयर करूँ। आपको पता है 1942 जब भी हम किसी आंदोलन की बात करते हैं तो वो केवल कुछ लोगों से सीमित नहीं होता है, वो जन लोगों से मासेस से जुड़ा होता है। और मासेस में अगर मैं बच्चों का नाम देखती हूँ तो मुझे सबसे ज़्यादा गर्व होता है, और वो भी छोटे बच्चे। और जब मैंने INA की विमेन रेजिमेंट को पढ़ा तो उसमें भी एक लड़की थी जिसका नाम था कुमारी सुशीला, एंड शी वॉज ओनली 13 ईयर्स ओल्ड वेन शी बिकेम पार्ट ऑफ द विमेन रेजिमेंट। दिस विमेन रेजिमेंट एज यू ऑल नो वॉज कॉल्ड द रानी ऑफ झांसी रेजिमेंट। मैंने केवल नाम से जाना कि ठीक है, इसका नाम तो था रानी ऑफ झांसी जो हमारे 18। लेकिन जब मैंने कुछ मैसेजेस पढ़े जो विमेन ने रेडियो के माध्यम से, ईस्ट एशिया में भी एक रेडियो ऑपरेट होता था, आज आप देखिए रेडियो कितना इम्पोर्टेंट है, हम सबको जोड़ता है कि नहीं। तो 1942 में एक सीक्रेट रेडियो इंडिया से भी शुरू हुआ था और वहाँ से कितने सारे मैसेजेस लोगों को प्राप्त होते थे कि उस वक्त क्या हालत थी, हमारे स्वतंत्रता सेनानियों ने किस किस तरह से कंट्रीब्यूट किया। लेकिन एक रेडियो ऐसा भी था जो आज़ाद हिंद रेडियो के नाम से जाना जाता था, और उस रेडियो में कई महिलाओं ने बढ़ चढ़ के योगदान दिया। उनके मैसेजेस में उनकी जीवनी नहीं थी, उन्होंने अपने मैसेजेस के द्वारा राष्ट्रीय प्रेम, राष्ट्रीय बलिदान, इन चीज़ों पे चर्चा किया जिसको मैं आपके साथ शेयर करना चाहती हूँ, क्योंकि मुझे भी लगा आई एम स्टिल लर्निंग। और अभी हमारे जितने भी स्पीकर्स हैं शायद उनसे मैं और सीखूंगी, लेकिन ये चीज़ मैं आप सबसे शेयर करना चाहती हूँ। एक जो विमेन थी वो कौन थी, क्या वो एक ही तबके की थी या कई प्रांतों की थी, और उनके नाम से कैप्टन मिसेस लक्ष्मी, कुमारी ईवा मूर्ति, कुमारी सुशीला, श्रीमती नगम्मा वासुदेवन, बलजीत कौर, प्रतिमा पाल, तो आप सोच सकते हैं दैट दे केम फ्रॉम वेरी बैकग्राउंड, डिफरेंट एज ग्रुप। और मैंने इन्हीं दस्तावेज में पढ़ा कि दे न्यू मलयालम, दे स्पोक इन तमिल, फ्यू ऑफ देम वर वेरी कन्वर्सेंट विद इंग्लिश, और एक क्लास चलती थी जहाँ पे लोगों को अनुवाद करके चीज़ों को बताया जाता था। दे अंडरवेंट थ्रू स्ट्रिक्ट मिलिट्री ट्रेनिंग, उनके अपने प्रसारण में रेडियो के माध्यम से वो अपना दिनचर्या बताती थी, और साथ ही साथ बताती थी दैट दे इंजॉयड एवरी बिट ऑफ इट बिकॉज द लव फॉर स्वराज वॉज द टॉप मोस्ट इन देयर माइंड। इमेजिन द पेट्रियोटिज्म दे हैड, एंड टूडे वेन यू सी विमेन ड्रेस्ड इन कॉम्बैट, डोंट वी फील प्राउड अबाउट इट? एंड आवर फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल इज सो रिच, so varied and so inspiring that I think when I go through it, I still feel I have much more to see the pages which maybe I have not seen. Now, I want to share something with you. One, what Netaji had said. In his Bangkok address, Netaji said, I quote, "I am sure that the presence of our sister in the fighting rank and in the Red Cross unit will be a powerful incentive to those wavering. It is not unprecedented experience to have our sisters fighting in a national emergency." About the Rani of Jhansi Regiment, Netaji in his own words said, "Among our first leader was a woman. She rode a horse and died heroically in the battle. She will never be forgotten." Women spoke from the Indian National Army radio station. So you can see for yourself ki unko kitna confidence tha hamari Indian women pe. East Asia mein unhone jab iska sthapna ki, usme unhone kai mahilaon ko, aur maine jab padha is kitab ko, to wo swechha se aati thi. Mahila apne bachchon ke saath bhi aati thi, and unko ek bada confidence tha ki yes, we will become part and parcel of winning Swaraj. To aap dekhiye, ek to unki participation, dusra jo secret radio maine likha aur jo Azad Hind se jo prachar hota tha wo hamesha samapt hota tha Vande Mataram pe. That was the song, clarion call for the song of this radio. And ek jo maine kaha jo bacche bolte the us waqt, aur maine kai swatantrata senani jo 1942 se jude the, balia aur aise jagah jahan maine interview kiya, to unhone ye kaha tha, wo log hamesha ye nare prabhat pheri mein bolte the, jhanda uncha rahe hamara. Aur Azad Hind ki jitni bhi mahilaen thi wo bhi swechha se gaati thi. Mere paas hai to likha bahut, lekin hum apne vaktaon se sunna chahenge. To main itna hi kehna chahungi ki hamari swatantrata se sangram mein mahilaon ka yogdan tha, aur jitne purush the, our freedom fighters had faith in the women. So was not our freedom struggle truly gendered? The National Education Policy 2020 reiterates to create pride in our students. What but the contribution of our leaders would make this living and instill among our children that our freedom struggle was vibrant, inspirational, with men, women, and children. Children don't participate just like that. They also had the urge of seeing Swaraj a dream for all our leaders who participated differently. And I feel very fortunate and very humble to be part of this. Thank you, Dinesh ji, for giving me this opportunity. And thank you, Sridhar ji, for including me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam. And definitely, you have touched one of the very important facet of the personality of Netaji, that to his vision of promoting women in freedom struggle. Now I am taking the opportunity to request Director NCRT Professor Sridhar Srivastava to address on this occasion first. Professor Sridhar Srivastava, sir.
Sabko namaskar. It is a very pride moment for me that I am getting an opportunity to listen to many big researchers, I would say, and on a topic which is very important. So first of all, I welcome on my personal behalf and on my behalf of, on the behalf of the institution, Professor Priyadarshi Mukherjee ji and Dr. Bhitin Thakur ji, whom we will be listening, and Professor Gauri Srivastava. She herself a faculty of history from NCERT, and Professor Dinesh Kumar ji, my Major Harsh Kumar, a very dynamic secretary of NCERT. So, and other colleagues from NCERT who are virtually connected on this occasion. As Dr. Dinesh Kumar ji was mentioning that 125th birth anniversary of Netaji, we are celebrating, and government has also issued certain communique to about this occasion. But I also want to place one very important point that I feel it is very important to say here, that we as an institution, we are involved in activities post National Education Policy 2020. And we are involved in several kind of activities, even otherwise, where we make attempts that these acts of NCERT through its books, through other suggestions, should touch upon the life of children in the last school, in the last village, because the efforts of the government under the aegis of Ministry of Education depends a lot on the support of NCERT. And on this occasion, I will be not taking much time at this spell, only a few points that the policy believes, and I quote from the policy, that the policy believes that the education system should develop children as a good human being with compassion, empathy, courage, resilience. And I feel that Netaji's life and his efforts in fighting against the imperial government in this country is a perfect example. And one more point I want to say, we at NCERT believe that book is the not the only medium through which we can instill or achieve all the learning outcomes that we intend to be achieved in the children. There are other mediums also, such programs, e-contents, and other opportunities provided to the children to instill in them the 21st century skill. This is one point. One more point we hold to our belief, that teacher is not the only agent which impacts the life of child. There are other agents like parents, other adult guidance in the family, and other persons around the child. And one more point we hold to our belief, that school is not the only learning space. Community or the society in which we are living, it is also a learning space. So keeping all these things in mind, I felt, and some of my colleagues, we were discussing, that on this occasion, we should not miss a chance, and we should listen to certain very prominent and well-known researchers in the area of history, and who have learned and researched a lot about the life of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. And this program is being aired on YouTube, and a good number of students from within NCERT are also connected. So they will get an opportunity, and they will get confidence and courage to think for the country, learning from the life of Netaji. With these words, I stop here, and I request now for further flow of programs. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for nice words and motivating words. And now, without wasting any time, I'm taking the opportunity to introduce the first speaker. He is none other than Professor Priyadarshi Mukherjee. He is a professor in Chinese language, literature, and cultural studies in Center for Chinese and Southeast Asian Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. and he is a passionate teacher, and his teaching since 1989 till date. And some of his publications I'm just quoting. It is very difficult for me because I googled and I got to know a lot more about him, but I'm just quoting some of his publications. One of his book published, it is on Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose and the Indian Liberation Movement in East Asia, Declassified Document in China and India. This is one publication. Another publication is Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, Contemporary Anecdotes, Reminiscences and Wartime Reportage. He has participated in many of the seminars, and these are all related to the life of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. One very important among those is patriotism of Subhash Chandra Bose and his relevance today. The other presentation in one of the commemorative address, the obliterated facets and irrefutable facts of the life of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Similarly, there are many more, so I would not take much time on this. I would now straight away request Professor Priyadarshi Mukherjee to please address the gathering, those who are present on a distant mode, and it is being streamed live on YouTube channel also, and it will be a great opportunity for all listeners to know about unknown facets of the life of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Professor Priyadarshi Mukherjee, sir, over to you.
Thank you, NCRT. Thank you, Dr. Dinesh Kumar, Professor Dinesh Kumar, the chairperson of the NCRT. Thank you very much for this opportunity. This morning, I was there in another program on Subhash Chandra Bose, organized by this IUAC, and that too talked about the same theme, but of course I have put another focus for this talk today afternoon. Now I will just briefly go through the rare facets of his life. Now, just now the other person in the panel, Auriji, was talking about the women's regiment. So in that context, I will start. On 21st of October 1943, Subhash Chandra Bose announced in Singapore the formation of the Provisional Government of Azad Hind. A striking feature of this government of Free India was the inclusion of a department designated for women. Now, can I share the screen with this? Is it possible?
Yeah, it is being shared, sir.
It is being shared?
Yeah, please do.
Okay.
We are getting it done, sir, from here.
Okay. Fine then. Now, yes. Despite, stiff resistance from the Japanese generals and some people from the Indian community in Southeast Asia, Subhash Chandra Bose went forward with his drive to give parity between men and women. So what he did is to form an armed battalion of women as well as the medical corps. So there were two wings, the combatants and the doctors. So it was reported that the occasion, quote, saw the birth of the first army of Indian sisters. Girls in their teens crowded the camp and threw themselves heart and soul into intensive military training. Today in India, we are still struggling to strike parity between genders in various spheres of life. This Rani of Jhansi, this particular regiment proved to be the first women's contingent in Asia. This has to be thought about, that during that time, he was the first one to raise an army of women in Asia. Netaji's immense valor, righteousness, and the spirit of sacrifice, as well as his enormous fellow feeling for the soldiers of the INA, have been incomparable. Netaji's concern and anxiety for the safety of the members of the women's regiment and the INA was remarkable during enemy's aerial bombardment and machine gun assault. Netaji refused to take shelter until the last of his soldiers had completed taking refuge. At the end of the war, when the Japanese offered a car for him alone, he did not and did not arrange for any conveyance for his soldiers, Netaji refused to go away alone. He marched from Rangoon to Bangkok through the jungles for 3 weeks with his soldiers amidst the enemy's assault. His empathy towards his combatants greatly impressed and endeared everyone, including the Japanese authorities. When the war was over, Bose quickly disbanded the women's battalion and sent the girls back home before the enemy could discover their identity. This he did to protect their honor. Now, these are the important points which should be emulated. Punctuality was the hallmark of Subhash Chandra Bose. His infinite knowledge of military affairs astounded Colonel Prem Kumar Sehgal, who recounted his day with Bose. The august personality of Netaji and his frank and informal way of dealing with people, his winsome courtesy, won everyone's heart. Netaji's unflinching faith in the final victory of India struck every individual. Now, he used to say that even if we are vanquished in the war, still we are going to win. I had interviewed one of these ladies of the INA, and she said in her interview that she heard, you know, that Bose was speaking about it, that even if we are defeated in the war, we are going to win because England will be, you know, going soon from India and will be bundled out within a few years and will be only getting shelter in their own island. Now, Sehgal wrote, quote, "No amount of wealth, power, or honor could make him deviate from his one-point zeal to break the shackles of India's slavery. He was so much above the ordinary run of politicians that he detested power politics. He believed in letting the masses decide what form of government they would like to have," unquote. Netaji's selfless dedication to his motherland remains unparalleled. The Japanese authority was impressed by Bose's stern insistence on maintaining the autonomy and honor of the INA, while other ethnic groups were invariably subjugated by the Japanese. Sleeping only 3 hours a day, Bose overworked, striving untiringly for the cause of India's freedom. Now, I would just mention certain very important points while the provisional government of Azadin was there in Singapore. The intercommunal harmony and mutual understanding struck a high note as Netaji was above all parochialism. Once Bose alone was invited to attend a temple ceremony, he is known to have refused to attend it without his Muslim generals. The temple authority had to relent. Netaji is also known to have mandated against preparing food according to various religious taboos. For example, you know, various people would have some religious taboos while preparing food that he did not allow to be followed. The food for the INA soldiers was prepared in a secular kitchen. Now, what does it mean? There was no sort of religious kind of considerations while preparing food. there was no separate site for any religious congregation. All were expected to pray at one single site. While in Singapore, he himself used to often offer his prayers at the Ramakrishna Mission, but never interfered with the spiritual practices of his soldiers. The secularism that post-1947 Indian politicians kept trumpeting was actually practiced by Netaji in all sincerity. Now, I would come to another point. Bose all along opposed Indian slavery of the British Raj. He kept his promise by hoisting the Indian flag on the Indian soil on 30th December 1943 in Andaman. He had already renamed Andaman as Shahid Islands and Nicobar as Swaraj Islands. That he did just 4 days ago, that is 26 December. But the names of the islands were never retained in post-1947 India, nor was Bose remembered as the founder of the Planning Commission, which he set up in 1938, nor was he given the credit of having sent a medical mission to China in 1938 as the Congress president. The war in Manipur was another such forgotten chapters that need to be revived. The INA War Museum in Moirang, where the Indian tricolor was hoisted on 14th April 1944, remains amidst utmost neglect. While stationed in Southeast Asia, Bose had built up a powerful administrative infrastructure for the post-independence India for training personnel. Bose went to the extent of printing currency notes, coins, and even postal stamps with the word Azad Hind transcribed on top. Now you can see the slide, you know, if you can show the slide, then I think people will understand.
Sir, it is requested, the slide has been closed from your end. Please share again.
Is it? Okay. Just a second, yeah. Where should I open it then? Just a second. I've clicked on it, but then, okay. Just a
second. Yeah, it is
now. You can see now?
Yeah, it is coming, sir. It is coming, sir.
Yeah, okay. This is the first page, and whereby you can see him standing in front of the cellular jail in Andaman. And the second one is in Tokyo, which he signed on 16th of November, 1943. Yeah. Now, the second slide is about the books I had written, you know, in 2008 and 9. So detailed content will be there if somebody is interested to read the books. And most of these documents have been taken from the books itself, which I had worked for almost 8 years. So these are the 20 chapters you will find, 10 each. Now, the third slide you can see, Azad Hind flag with a springing tiger, a free India written in German, Freies Indien. Now, this flag was actually introduced in Germany. Now, when he reached Southeast Asia, he found that already the local Indians and the Indian Independence League had already been using the Congress flag of spinning wheel, charkha, you know, there. So he didn't change it afterwards. Now, this is another picture, Subhash Chandra Bose in civilian attire and in army uniform, how he looked, you know. During a broadcast he was making around that time. And then I will come to the next point. Just a second. Now, I'll just quickly go to the other point of, these are the photographs all the Azadid bank notes and coin, and there are some stamps also. You can see pictures are there. Then the next point is when the hours arrived for the Indians to cast off slavery, Britain in 1947 put an Anglophile on their relinquished throne of the bleeding and truncated India. Such was the dread of the British about Bose's aligning with the anti-British forces, the Axis power, that Churchill had ordered to assassinate Bose in 1941. Now, one should remember that in January 1941, Bose escaped from his house arrest. And through Afghanistan, of course, in Afghanistan, he stayed for 1.5 months there. And then he went to Moscow and then to Berlin. Now, during that time, the British spies were unleashed. And in Turkey and Iran, they were waiting for Bose to pass, and then they will try to assassinate him. But luckily, Bose traveled from another route, so he was saved. His raising an army that could challenge the British rule unnerved the British so much that in February 1944, some British spies were sent twice to assassinate Bose while in Burma. Now, in my book, I have already given the detailed account of that assassination attempts. This demonstrates the fact that Bose was the sole enemy of the British Empire, as exemplified through the production of a BBC-sponsored documentary film, The Enemy of the Empire. Now, produced by Charles Bruce, you know, who used to be the anchor of that time. The stigma of fascism wrongly labeled against Bose was sought to be removed by the British intelligence officer Hugh Toy, American historians Joyce Lebra and Leonard Gordon through their biographies and historical accounts on Bose, and not by the court historians in India. We are still in the dark about whether the war criminal tag was removed from his name by the UN. Now, we can easily see in late 90s also, we were just trying to figure out that whether this tag was kind of removed or not. You know, the present regime can try to see and figure out and remove the tag. Now, we come to the other point. On 24th of December 1944, Netaji addressed a mammoth rally held in Singapore. Netaji made a survey of the Second World War scenario. The IIL, that is Indian Independence League, published a booklet titled Netaji's Masterly Survey of War in East and West. He covered the inner contradiction within the Allied powers. Soviet Union and the Anglo-Americans, the hostility between Britain and America, and the danger Britain felt in maintaining their naval force in the Pacific. Britain was apprehensive of Australia and Canada going under the American influence. Bose's analysis of the post-war political scenario was superb. All his forecasts turned true. Now, if you read that book, it will be very interesting. Subhash Bose, in his relentless quest for achieving freedom for India, devised a strategy so as to bring about a Sino-Japanese rapprochement. That means they should have a sort of understanding to end the war. By advocating peace between China and Japan, Bose sought to get greater Japanese military assistance and involvement in the Indian cause, since the vast majority of the Japanese forces were virtually bogged down in controlling China. He sought to divert the entire Japanese focus towards fighting the Anglo-Americans in India, and on the other hand, let the Chinese seek independence from the Japanese control. It is widely acknowledged that following Bose's advice, Japan refused to declare war against the Soviet Union. Nazi Germany was an example whereby it waged a two-front war against the Anglo-Americans. So did the Japanese. Why? Because, you know, in the southern side, if you see the history, then both Germans and the Japanese were involved in fighting against Britain and America at the same time. Later, it would have been a folly had Japan opened a third front against these Russians. Now, these Russians were on the northern side. Now, in the southern side, they were already involved in the war against the Anglo-Americans. And if they open another front in the north, they will be totally sandwiched between the two. So, hence, Bose's advice was accepted by the Japanese, especially after the defeat of Germany and Italy by mid-1945. Netaji's forming of an army was solely directed towards fighting the British colonial forces in India and never against any other power. Therefore, the Free Indian Legion raised by Bose in Germany refused Hitler's order to fight against Soviet Union. Thus, several Indian soldiers were mercilessly executed by Hitler. Similarly, Bose refused to send his men to fight the anti-Japanese guerrilla groups from China and Burma. Now, if we see the history, we can see that it was Bose's clear and categorical instruction to his soldiers that our only enemy is the British colonialists in India and no one else. So you should not point your gun at anybody else. And that was the cost, you know. Hitler ordered the Indian soldiers staying in Germany to fight against the Soviet Union, and the Indian soldiers refused. And that's why Hitler killed them. Now, similarly, the anti-Japanese groups were there. China, Burma, they were fighting against the Japanese occupation. And Aung San Suu Kyi's father was there, who joined that anti-Japanese war around that time. Now, that is why later, during the INA trial at the Red Fort, the Japanese statesman, later foreign minister, Shigemitsu Mamoru, and many other Japanese who had come for deposition were full of reverence for Bose. They honored Bose. They said that he was not a puppet. They declared that INA or Bose were never puppets. In fact, Joyce Lebra termed Bose as the weakest ally of the Japanese. We can very well witness from all the evidences available in our disposal that Bose and the INA were far superior in terms of dedication, consciousness, and conscience. Now, I will give you more interesting things when you see that in 1929, as early as 1929, in one of the conferences, students' conference, on 19th October 1929, Subhash Bose was saying that there is no royal road to freedom. The path to freedom, no doubt, is a thorny one, but it is a path which also leads to glory and immortality. Now, Subhash Bose was elected president of the Congress in 1938. Now, if you see his speech, at the end, he talks about that, I'm sure that India and her culture would become known and appreciated by people abroad. Such films would prove exceedingly useful to Indian students and Indian residents in other countries who at present are like non-official ambassadors of the country. I do not like the word propaganda. There is an air of falsity about it. But I insist that we should make India and her culture known to the world, unquote. Now, very interestingly, he was making comparisons, you know, between the soft power culture, what we are now speaking about in the world, he had already talked about long ago. Now here, I will just highlight certain points. When you can recall that Haripura Congress, you know, he was elected, but then second time when he stood for the election, Gandhi opposed it. And then, you know, on the 10th of March in Tripuri Congress, he actually, you know, gave the ultimatum to the British Empire that within 6 months you have to leave India or face a war. Now you can see the foresight that in March he said it, and by September that year, the Second World War in Europe started. Now here, one interesting part of history is there, that Rabindranath Tagore, you know, he actually sided with Subhash Bose and said to Gandhi that your going against Subhash Bose is very unjustified. And therefore he called Subhash Bose to Shantiniketan and conferred upon him the title Desh Nayak. Now, after that, Gandhi also came to Rabindranath and had a talk, but then their, you know, sort of roads towards freedom was absolutely divergent, not the same, because Gandhi, you know, refused to take back Subhash into the Congress. Subhash Bose actually believed in the political axiom, enemy's enemy is my friend. Now, from that point of view, if you see that the entire world politics rotates around this kind of axiom. Now, this happened with the Americans when they were fighting against Britain for independence. They brought French forces, French army, and fought against the British army. Lenin toppled the Russian Tsar through the help of the Germans. Same thing happened when, you know, Stalin actually gave up all his ideological baggage. Ideological baggage means the socialist baggage, capitalist baggage, and aligned with the Anglo-Americans to fight against Hitler. And very interestingly, 1840, when the Opium War started between China and UK, now Britain had already become a sworn enemy of the Chinese. But when Japan started attacking China, Britain automatically became a friend of China. Now this is very, very interesting, that enemy's enemy is my friend. Now, from that point of view, if you see, then Subhash's formulation, thinking that whoever is the enemy of the British Empire should be my friend. So therefore, in 1930s, he had already gone to Italy and befriended the Italian leader, Benito Mussolini. Now here we can see that how he had already planned well about this. Now, when the war started, he met Hitler, he met Tojo, everyone. Now his 1-point program of his life was full freedom for the country. Very interestingly, the fact sheet says that within 9 to 10 years of time, Subhash Chandra Bose was imprisoned at least 11 times and without a case, you know. And once he was sent into Mandalay jail in Burma for 2.5 years between 1924 and 1927. Now, when he was again arrested in 1940, he started with his hunger strike and he was reverted back to his home under house arrest. And from there, he slipped out, from home, on 17th January 1941. Interesting part of this discourse is that I want to read for my audience some letters he had written from prison when he was last time jailed, in 1940, end of that year, to his elder brother, Sharad Chandra Bose. He had written two letters. One was dated 24th of October, 1940. He wrote, quote, "The latest phase of Gandhism with its sanctimonious hypocrisy, its outrage of democracy and its queer and ununderstandable formula for political ills is sickening. One is forced to wonder which is a greater menace to India's political future, the British bureaucracy or Gandhian hierarchy," unquote. Just a few days later, on 31st of October, 1940, from jail, he wrote another piece of letter to his brother, Sharad Chandra. Quote, "The more I think of Congress politics, the more convinced I feel that in future, we should devote more energy and time to fighting the high command. If power goes into the hands of such mean, vindictive, and unscrupulous persons when Swaraj is won, what will happen to the country? If we don't fight them now, we shall not be able to prevent power passing into their hands. Another reason why we should fight them now is that they have no idea of national reconstruction. Gandhism will land free India in a ditch. If free India is sought to be rebuilt on Gandhian non-violent principles, India will then be offering a standing invitation to all predatory powers," unquote. Now, this was very powerful in its entire, tone, intonation. Why I read that? Because there is a sort of wrong concept, which is being floated, that he was reconciled with the idea of transfer of power. No, he was not. He was the only statesman. I would say he was a statesman, And that you can see through his kind of speeches and writings and his works, that what he did was actually the uncompromising patriotism, that I will not let the British partition my country. This was the only person who opposed it in practical, sense. Now, we come to, I think you can see the slides, at the Greater East Asia Conference in Tokyo. He was giving a speech. In this slide, you can see. And then prior to that, when he had gone, from Germany to East Asia, this was the picture on the deck of the submarine. The captain was there of the submarine Werner Muesenberg. And the second photograph on this slide is with Abid Hassan, with whom he was traveling in the same U-boat. It was called U-boat. the German submarine U-180 type. The second slide here is on the deck of the Japanese submarine. Now you can see in this picture, there are Japanese ratings along with Bose and Abe-san. The other slide is 21st of October 1943, the Provisional Government of Azad Hind was founded in Singapore. This was the, he was reading out the entire proclamation. And these were the generals who were standing at the back in the other picture. This was the Rani Jhansi Regiment. Lakshmi Swaminathan was there, who later became Sehgal after marrying Prem Kumar Sehgal, you know, after independence. So she was there and they were taking the guard of honor. Now, the rest of the pictures you have seen, and later we can come to the other point. I will just come to that point. Now here you can see this piece that he had been the only person who had opposed the racist intonation which Hitler gave into his autobiography, Mein Kampf. That is my struggle, you know, in that book. He was, you know, reflecting upon his kind of a racist attitude towards the Indians. So he, Subhash Bose, opposed it openly. Now, in a book, we had found that this Leonard Gordon's, just now I had quoted, his book actually reflects upon certain aspects. You can see that the Indian communists were actually slandering Bose from the very beginning of the war. As soon as Soviet Union joined the war against Hitler, the Indian communists jumped into the bandwagon and saying that it is a people's war. Prior to that, they were saying that it is a war of the capitalist powers. Now, suddenly we find a host of cartoons made against Bose. Now, this slight picture, you can see that Indian communist incessant vilification campaign against Subhash Chandra Bose. Now, this I have found in the, you know, the book written by Leonard Gordon, The Brothers Against the Raj, biography of Charchandra and Subhash Chandra Bose. This book is a thick one. And in this book, you can see a lot of cartoons are there, you know, ridiculing Bose, and slandering actually, you know, in various types of forms, you know, you can see that in this picture. And then, you know, in fact, if we see that, what was the role of these communists? They were in the role of the British. They used to be paid and they used to be the agents to be traitors against the Indian freedom fighters. Many were actually, you know, in the payrolls, and that has been declassified now in the British archives. Now, when actually on 29th of May 1943, Bose realized after meeting Hitler that it is futile to, you know, bank upon German help for going to India for a fight. So therefore, Oshima Hiroshi, you know, the Japanese ambassador in Berlin, he actually proposed Subhash Bose's travel to Tokyo and meeting Tojo. And Tojo was, of course, hesitant. He said that we have another Bose here, you know, Rajbihari Bose. No, Rajbihari Bose was already there. He was already a citizen of that country. You know, Rajbihari Bose was already in the confidence. Now, Tojo took time to meet Subhash Bose. Now, when finally he met, he was so pleased that he invited Subhash Bose to the Japanese parliament. And Subhash Bose went there and gave a speech. And there, Tojo pledged full support for India's independence. Now we come to some other point. Now, another important part of it is that Bose was known for his disguise and taking pseudonyms. Now, when he slipped out of his house arrest in 41, he took a pseudonym and a disguise of a Muslim insurance agent named Muhammad Ziauddin. Later on, he took an Italian passport with the name Orlando Mazzotta to travel from Afghanistan via Moscow to Berlin. When he was traveling in a submarine and disembarked in Indonesia, around Sabang, Penang, all these places, he took another name of a Japanese VIP, Matsuda, and traveled from there to Tokyo in another submarine and reached Tokyo on 16th of May, 1943. And this entire submarine trip, you know, from Germany to Southeast Asia and Tokyo took 90 days, that is full 3 months. If you read the book written by Abid Hasan, it's very clear according to the dates, you see. Now, after reaching Burma, you know, after reaching Burma and Singapore, Bose found that there had been a famine. 1943, the British had artificially created a famine. Bengal famine is very infamous in history. So millions of people died, you know, of starvation. And this was artificially created by Churchill's order. And here, of course, we see that Bose immediately dispatched, you know, quintals of rice to India by ship. But unfortunately, these were all confiscated by the British and let them rot in the storehouse. The reason they gave was that we should not allow the hungry people to know that this rice has been sent by Subhash Chandra Bose. So it is better to, you know, allow them to be rotten in the storehouse. So thus, you know, 5 million people died. Now, the part of history is that after taking the charge of the INA, he regrouped the soldiers and gave them education in patriotism. Now, prior to that, Tojo said that these are the Indian soldiers who had been fighting against us. And how will you re-educate them? So Bose took the challenge, and within 3 months, he re-educated them in such a way, and that entire syllabus books are still available in the archives. So there were a lot of activities there to kind of rejuvenate the Indians. And in the process, after the establishment of the Provisional Government of Free India, there were 9 countries who had actually recognized, or 9 power centers, we can say, that they actually recognized Bose's Provisional Government of Azad Hind. Now, these were Germany, Italy, then you have Japan, Thailand, Burma, Philippines, Croatia, then you have this Manchuria and the Nanjing-based government of China under Wang Jingwei. Now, all these countries actually kind of recognized his government. And then there are other details that this provisional government's offices were opened in Denmark, France, and Soviet Union at various places. For example, in Copenhagen in Paris and in southern Siberian city of Omsk, three offices were operating of the INA or the IIL, you know. So we can see that lots of activities were there and there was acceptance for a free India. In my book, what I have dealt with, you know, in details, you know, the kind of account is there, that what I found in both in the Indian archives as well as the Chinese archives. The Chinese archives will reflect upon his visit to China. You know, Subhash Bose visited China on 17th of November 1943 from Fukuoka. He flew to Nanjing, you know, and met the then president, Wang Jingwei. Now, after that, they, you know, fixed some meetings, and Bose went to the mausoleum of Dr. Sun Yat-sen, and then he congregated many Indians at the Bund in Shanghai. Again, in Shanghai, you know, he went around 21st of that month and then regrouped them, impelling them to join the army for country's freedom. His second trip to China was on 30th November 1944, the next year. Same November was there, but date had changed. Now, his second trip was very short, and he went to the training center of the INA in Baoxing Road, Shanghai, and where he gave speeches impelling them to join the freedom struggle. Here, Abidhasan's account is there, long account is there, I won't read it. Then on 26th of November, 1943, news conference in Tokyo, he had said that I'm going to change the name of Andaman and the Nicobar Islands. You know, Andaman Nicobar Islands were renamed as Shahid and Swaraj Islands on 26th of November. And 30th of November, he went and hoisted the flag in Andaman. Now he kept his promise, you know, as he had said to the British that I am going to land and hoist a flag there. 7th of January, 1944, the provisional government of Azad Hind was shifted. The headquarters was shifted from Singapore to Rangoon, which was closer to India. And on 4th of February, 1944, the final military campaign started. You know, the INA marched into the soil of India. And this was very specific. One has to take cognizance of this fact that the Japanese were not allowed to step first into the Indian soil. Subhash Chandra Bose said that if the Japanese are seen marching into the Indian soil, they will be taken as aggressors. And the Japanese too were very conscious about this fact. So an entire battalion under an Indian captain, Rathore, he was there, and under him, the Japanese army, they entered into the Indian soil with a huge contingent of Indian troops as well, you know. And when we see that the British had consistently stopped or jammed the radio broadcast, you know, disallowing the people to know about the facts of history. The fact is this, that the INA was the first one to step into the Indian soil. Briefly, I will just go that on the one hand, as you see, that there is a term called Azad Hind Fauj. The Azad Hind Fauj actually coined another name for the British Indian Army, which was called Ghulam Hind Fauj. Now, if we see the pamphlets of that time, we will understand that Azad Hind and Ghulam Hind Fauj was there. Now, after marching into India, Manipur's 3/4 part was under the control of the INA for 4 or 5 months before the rain started, actually. But when the rain started, they had to retreat, and in the process, bombing happened and so many things occurred that total of 26,000 people died from the INA. If we say, now there is a sort of common saying by the court historians of India that Subhash Chandra Bose had been a fascist. Now, this is absolutely wrong, you know. Just by aligning for the freedom of one's own country, one cannot be termed as a fascist, you see. For a fascist to happen, he has to be merciless, and all these aspects are there, as you term as, you know, Hitler, Tojo, and all these people were having, you know, ruthlessness in their acts. But Subhash Chandra Bose did not ever kill any person, even execute even one. So therefore, Prem Kumar Sehgal, Dhillon, and so many people termed him as an incarnation of compassion, you know. Now here, I will just skip some points because there is hardly any time, probably. How much time we have?
We'll conclude now because we have another speaker also.
Yeah. Because we started late, so I calculated.
We understand this, sir. You have a lot of material.
No problem. Okay. Yeah. Now, another point, you know, among the rare facets is that we know about the submarine voyage of Bose, but many people, or most people, they don't know that the Japanese used to bring the Indian INA people by submarine into the Bay of Bengal area and disembark them near the Chilka Lake, you know, and near the Chilka Lake in the deep sea. They were disembarked from the sea, from the ship. And they used to use rubber boats and travel all the way into Chilka Lake and enter India. These were actually the INA agents, you know, with transmitters in their hand, so that they can give the actual picture of what is happening inside India back to their headquarters in Rangoon. So this went on for some time, but unfortunately, they fell prey to treachery. You know, some people who came to know about their, you know, existence, they caught them and hanged them, you know. So, and there are very many stories about these wartime, you know, experiences, but I'm not going to talk about it. But last, but not the least, probably, is on 8th July 1945 in Singapore at the Connaught Drive, Subhash Bose laid the foundation of the INA Memorial Tomb that was constructed within a month. By August, it was constructed. And on that, it was written Ekta, Vishwas, and Balidan in Urdu. You know, Ittihad, Itmad, and Qurbani. These three words were written. But as soon as Mountbatten came and recaptured Singapore, he immediately destroyed the whole tomb. And so you won't find it now, except in Esplanade, you can see a small tomb now commemorating the INA's. Thank you. kind of sacrifice, you know, at that time. Now, Li Tinghui, one of the authors in Singapore, he said that had there been no assistance from Bose, I would not have been born, you know. Actually, what he meant is the Japanese had interned or, you know, kept the Chinese in a concentration camp for a long time. And Bose came to know about it, and he got the Chinese freed from the hands, you know, the Japanese captors. I think, end here. Much of it has been said, and thank you very much. And if you have anything to ask, then we can talk about afterwards.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I would request only one or two questions maximum, if at all any participant is having. Sir, you can please close your presentation.
Yes. Now, you see, there had been lot of speeches he had, delivered. One of the speeches was in December 1944 in Singapore, when he was talking about, you know, masterly survey of war in East and West. Just now I have talked about it. But here he was also talking about how, you know, planning should be done, reconstruction should be done, you know. But unfortunately, what has happened, you know, the question arises, why, you know, here another point I should raise, that after the war, we often go to the Northeast, and often my friends say that they have seen some cemeteries, tombstones, you know, of the soldiers. Now, who were these soldiers who were marked as unknown soldiers? Recently, one British officer, retired officer, he said that we had deliberately put the tombstone with unknown soldier tag for the INA. Now, my question is that after 1947, why our government did not try to unravel the truth by taking out the body and find out that who were these people, you know, so that those people could have been honored, you know. Unfortunately, in India Gate, what is being done is honoring the people who had fought for the protection of the British Empire in the First World War, and not the people who fought for independence of India. Now, this I feel is quite dishonorable.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Very true, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, thank you so much. And it was really a wonderful presentation, and a lot of things which we never heard in our life, and that you have really shared with all of us. And as I have mentioned, that only one or two questions can be allowed, not more than that. So very quickly, any one from the audience, they can just raise their hand or send a message. We can unmute his or her mic, or otherwise we can switch over to the next presentation. Professor Mukherjee, please close your presentation, sir.
Okay. Sir. I'll just do that. Yes. Presentation is
any audience want to ask?
The slideshow. Also?
Yeah, it is switched off, sir. Thank you so much, sir. So, aap message mein dekhiye agar koi hai to, if any audience is having a chat. And there is no one. Yeah, it's all right. So I am taking the opportunity to switch over to our next speaker. And as I have mentioned earlier, that we have deliberately decided on this occasion to have speeches of those who have either worked intensively or studied a lot about Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. So the other speaker is Dr. Bithin Thakur, and he is a faculty in Central University of Tamil Nadu, and he has done his PhD on Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. The title of his PhD thesis was "The Strategy of Subhash Chandra Bose in Freedom Struggle of India, with reference to his alliance with the Axis power from 1897 to 1945. Anyway, So the topic of deliberation of Dr. Bithin Thakur would be freedom struggle of Subhash Chandra Bose with a special reference to Andaman. In brief, I'll say that I have seen some of the publications of Dr. Bithin Thakur on internet also, since we have already lost a lot of time. And so therefore, I will straight away request Dr. Thakur to come into and deliver his speech on Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. And Dr. Bithin Thakur, please. Dr. Thakur, please.
Yes. It was muted. So,
Thank you.
Good afternoon, all. And without taking much time, first of all, let me thank the organizing committee, National Council of Education and Research and Training, and so for organizing this webinar on Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose on his 125th birth anniversary. As government have declared as a Parakram Divas, and which will be celebrated for this year. I take the opportunity to thank Professor Professor Srivastava, and I record my thanks to Professor Dinesh Kumar, who have invited me for who have provided me this opportunity to present a talk on Subhash Chandra Bose. From my childhood, I admired about Bose, and that I think so everybody would have done. So I got interested doing research on Bose while I was doing my MPhil research. My MPhil topic was Japanese invasion in Andaman. And that time there I come across that Bose, he visited Andaman and he hoisted flag in Andaman, the tricolor flag in Andaman. And he renamed the island to Swaraj and Sahib. But there on questions, a question which arrived here or like arose in my mind, that the Japanese were having atrocities in Andaman. By that time, Japanese were literally torturing the people of Andaman. And by that time, Subhash Bose became the head of Andaman. And after his visit also, nothing changed. Why is it so? So then I thought like I should find out what happened, what is the reason behind that. And that brought an interest in me to find about Bose more. So I, in my PhD, I took the topic of Bose and I basically worked on his strategies. And before me, Professor Mukherjee have given a very detailed, picture of or freedom struggle of about Bose. And so I think still I'll, considering the time, I'll briefly point out few things which I want to say. So let us start with Bose becoming the head of Andamanico Island. It happened when the Southeast Asian Conference started and Bose was in Japan. And how Bose landed to Japan, that we all know, but anyways, I'll be coming that later. And when Bose was in Japan, there was this Southeast Asian Conference which held in November of 1943, to be precise, 5th to 6th November 1943. And Bose was asked by Tojo, the Prime Minister of Japan, to participate in the conference. Bose refused that. When I am not representing any part or any territory of India, how can I participate in this conference? Then Tojo assured him that Bose will be made as the head of Andaman equivalent, which was part of Japan by that time, and which was taken by Japan in 1942 from the British. So Bose was made as the head of Andaman, and he visited Andaman in 30th December 1943. And before that, in 26th, he declared that the name of Andaman Island will be Swaraj and Sahid. And when he visited Andaman, actually, he was kind of hoodwinked by the Japanese. The Japanese officers there, they have not showed him how torture or what is the real condition of the people. But anyways, when he went to Andaman and he made sure that they are in good condition, and for that he appointed a Colonel Loganathan as representative on behalf of him to Andaman, and he came back to Japan. And that is the time when he wanted, or like he was, he already formed the army and he wanted to fight against the British. And after coming back from Andaman, he went for the fight and to Burma. And that is the reason why he could not concentrate on Andaman. So the question which I had, that whether for the atrocities which were taken place in Andaman, whether for that Netaji can be blamed or not. So partially, you can say that Netaji can be blamed that, but we have a justification for that because the country India was bigger cause than Andaman, and so he fought for and he sacrificed his main aim was to fight for Indian nation, so he did that. So let us come to now let us see some of his important thing in his life. So we all know that he was born in Odisha Cuttack in the year of 23rd January 1897, and then on 23rd April 1921 he refused to join the civil service because he felt that the major cause, he don't want to serve the British, and rather he want to fight against the British and make his country free from that. And by that time, when he came back to India, Indian National Congress was the only party which represent India. So he joined Indian National Congress, and with without not much time, he became very favorite of all the members, and Gandhi nominated him the leaders of National Congress nominated him as a president in 1938, and he was elected as the president by 1938. Now the change starts from here. In 1938, he was nominated by the Congress member as the president of National Congress. And when he wins, he started changing the governing system of Indian National Congress. And when he does that, it was a clear threat for the other Congress leaders. And so when he wanted to elect, go for the election in next year, 1939, Gandhi opposed it. And Gandhi told that you should not go for election. And he Pattabhi Sitaramaiah stood against Subhash Chandra Bose and says that he is my candidate, and if the defeat of Sitaramaiah will be defeat of mine. And but unfortunately, Sitaramaiah was defeated and Bose became the president. And that make Congress so alarmed that if the man can defeat the candidature of Mahatma Gandhi, then no other leader can stand in front of him. So it is better that we should marginalize him from the Congress. And that's what happened. They made him totally unfunctionable, and later he resigned from Congress, and that made him, or that gave him a view, or he became so realistic, understanding that being inside the country, he cannot get, or he cannot fight for the cause what he was doing. So he wanted to fight for the country, and for that he wanted to take help of other countries, which are basically the enemies of Britain. So he had a policy of enemy's enemy is my friend, which was not at all liked by Congress. And when he went and took the support, he made escape in 1941, and he went through Kabul, Moscow, and then finally landed in Germany. And he tried to get help from Germany, and he had a conversation with Hitler. And Hitler was not willing to help him and told that probably you can go and seek help from Japan. So he moved from Germany to Japan, and he made his journey through a U-boat, and that is the first human transport in submarine that happened. So thing is that when he was in German, and in previous year in 1930s when he was in abroad, he already understood that the ideologies or the policies of Indian National Congress is not going to get freedom to India. So it is, if you want to get or if you want to fight the cause, he have to meet the people other side who are ready to willing or ready to help him. So he met Hitler, Mussolini, and other people. And here we can see that people have made it like, or gave comment that Subhas Bose, he made the fascist and he is a fascist. So I like, as sir have mentioned rightly, that he was not a fascist, and we cannot see in his speeches or anywhere that he have supported any activities or anything which was done by these leaders. He was so clear in his view that his only one aim is to fight against the British. And when in Germany, he formed the Indian Legion, and when Germany wanted them to fight against Russia, he ordered them not to do that. And so like the Legion didn't fight against them. So we can see there was a clear vision. Okay, like I think so. So there was a clear concept of idea what Bose had, that he have to fight only with British and he don't have to follow any other, like, and he didn't accept any of the conditions of the other countries. And when he was not supported by German, he moved to Japan, and where he was welcomed by Tozo and Rajbihari Bose. Though initial time Tozo was not willing to meet him, but like after meeting him, he Bose had such a such a character, he can convince anyone. So that after meeting Bose, Tozo also convinced, and he told that he is ready to give or all the support whatever is needed. So there, Japan, there was already an army which was made by Captain Mohan Singh, which was there, that is called IIL, and which was handed over officially by Rajbihari Bose to Subhas Chandra Bose. And Subhas Chandra Bose took over the in charge of that army, and he trained them with the help of army, with the Japanese army. And then he initiated, or like he made sure that there should be a regiment which is made out of women. And that is the first regiment we can call the Jhansi Rani Regiment, which was started by Subhas Chandra Bose. Though initially Japan have opposed it, and some other communities, people from India also opposed it, that how, women can be in the army. But then he gave the example of 1857 revolt, where Jhansi Rani have fought, and he told that he fought till her last breath. And so we have already example of example of women fighting the war. So, and he convinced, and he is the first to made a woman regiment in Asia, where Lakshmi Sehgal was the head of that regiment. And mainly this work of this regiment was nursing, doctoring, and plus they had the combat also. There were the army also. So in this process of this war, Subhas Chandra Bose had landed in India, and he made a treaty with Japan that whenever the Indian army or the Indian National Army is landing to India, there should not be any Japanese leader or Japanese army which will be landing to India. And because he wanted, when India is fighting in the land of India, there should be only Indian armies. And he reached till the Nagaland, where we know the place Kohima, and from there they were there almost for 6 months, and then they have to retaliate back because of heavy rain and mosquitoes, and then they didn't have proper supply of medicine and other things. So they came back, they have to come back from there, but he didn't live this. Then again he made a second mission, and till 1945, till the Japanese have surrendered in the Second World War, he continued fighting for the country, and it is only when Japanese have surrendered in 1945 so that he have to push back because he is not getting any kind of support, and most of his army was not having proper supply and medications, and they were wounded, and so he have to retreat back in 1945. Then also he thought that he'll be having this war continued with the help of Russia. That was the plan. And it was told that he have moved to Russia, but the report says that on 18 August 1945, he died in a plane crash. But my question is here that we have seen that Bose was a person with realistic view. He understood very clearly that without the armed struggle, it is not possible for India to achieve independence. Because this he understood by seeing studying the history of other countries. No other countries have achieved independence without the help of armed struggle. So, and he had a pure belief that Gandhi won't get cannot achieve independence with the help of non-violence. So he had to take this step. And when he have sacrificed this much for the country, I think so that it is very unfortunate that he is not remembered for his contribution or for the country. And when this is, as I've told, he was marginalized in the year of 1939 itself, and that continued at present day itself. When we take the history of modern India, we are told that the India got freedom through non-violence. I agree that non-violence had a major role to play for the freedom movement. But then what happened to the people who have sacrificed their life without any selfishness, like people like Prafulla Chaki, people like Bhagat Singh, Khudiram Bose, people like Chandrasekhar Azad, and 26,000 soldiers of INA who have sacrificed their life in the war, in second war, fighting with the British Army. What happened to them? Then why they are not recorded in the history? So it is very unfortunate that we try to forget or we make an effort to undermine the work which was done by Subhash Chandra Bose or his army INA. And it is very evident when in 1956, Clement Attlee, who came to India, who is the one who signed on the pact of transfer of power giving to India, when he came to in 1956, when he came to India, he had a meeting with governor, that time governor, Pani Bhushan Chakravarti. And when he asked that in 1942, when the Quiet India Movement that got end in 1944, then why you have to leave India? Then he told, it is not because of the non-violence or the other condition. It is because of INA and the revolt of Royal Indian Navy, which happened in 1946. And British understood when this military, they have revolted against them, then there is no stay for them, because hardly there are only 93,000 British anytime in India, and they are ruling over 33 crores of Indian people. So it is the Indian people or the Indian who are serving as British army, one based on our power of them only, they have survived. So it is not non-violence alone brought the independence to India. There was also a great role which was played by the personalities like Bhagat Singh and Subhash Chandra Bose and the INA soldiers. So I think that we should give the importance to them also in history, which is not there now. So we are running out of time, and I had a lot of things to tell, but like due to time concern, so I think so we'll wind up here. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Thakur. And very rightly at the end, you have mentioned that the contributions of INA and Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose has not really been recognized and honored appropriately. I sincerely hope that the declaration of Parakram Divas by the Government of India and year-long ceremony will definitely go a long way in recognizing all the contributions. And I sincerely hope that all organizations who are working in the field of education or even other organization, cultural organizations, should also come out wherever things are there, and that should be brought to the limelight about the contribution of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. So with this, I really take this opportunity to thank both the speaker. But before we end, I would request the chair of the session, Director NCERT, Professor Sridhar Srivastava, to give his concluding remarks. Professor Srivastava, sir.
Thank you, Professor Dinesh Ji. So we listened to these two speakers, and it was a very nice opportunity to know about different facets of the life of Netaji, and associated with that, the efforts that he as an individual put into the freedom of this country in which we are taking breath so independently and all. But I just want to say here that there is a quote of Swami Vivekananda, that all great undertakings are confronted with mighty obstacles. So the kind of happenings that took place at that time also, like one of the speaker was mentioning about the 1936, when he became the president of INC, and then his efforts or his acts were quite favorable to the need of that time, but that was also viewed by some others in different manner. So these kind of things happens all the time, and we have to face such kind of things, but efforts should be made. That is the dictum or the conclusion that we should draw from these happenings. And so with these things, I would just be, since we all have the paucity of time, and a lot of things were placed here, and we became richer by our knowledge, and we would be reflecting on that. We as an institution will be deriving some and maybe a good amount of benefit from these speeches. Thank you. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, sir, for your concluding remark. And before we end, I would request Secretary NCERT, Major Harsh Kumar, to propose a vote of thanks.
माँ भारती को प्रणाम करते हुए, माँ भारती के इस महान सपूत अमर शहीद सुभाष चंद्र बोस के जयंती पर हमारे सरकार द्वारा, हमारे यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री जी द्वारा इसको पराक्रम दिवस मनाने को लेकर के मैं संपूर्ण राष्ट्र को बधाई देता हूं। तो इस पराक्रम दिवस पर उपस्थित माननीय निदेशक महोदय, सामाजिक विज्ञान की अध्यक्षा प्रोफेसर श्रीवास्तव मैडम, इस कार्यक्रम के संयोजक प्रोफेसर दिनेश कुमार जी, और इस सभा को अपने ज्ञान से आलोकित करने वाले प्रोफेसर प्रियदर्शी मुखर्जी और डॉक्टर विपिन ठाकुर, मैं आपका हृदय से धन्यवाद करता हूं कि आपने इस सभा में, इस अनुपम सभा में, जिसमें कि हमारे सारे फैकल्टीज, हमारे विद्यार्थी और ओपन फोरम से जो हमारे जिज्ञासु और राष्ट्रभक्त जुड़े, उनको आपने नेताजी के अनछुओं पहलुओं की जानकारी दी। नेताजी शब्द सुनते ही शरीर में एक झुरझुरी सी, एक ऐसा जोश, एक ऐसा राष्ट्र के प्रति ऐसा भक्त की एक छवि उत्पन्न होती है, जो कि स्वयं के अंदर एक जोश भर देती है। और आपने नेताजी के जीवन के उन पहलुओं को छुआ जिससे हम कदाचित जानकारी हमें नहीं थी। हालांकि एनसीईआरटी ने इस विषय पे, नेताजी के विषय पे किताब भी निकाली हुई है, और आगे भी जैसा हमारे माननीय निदेशक महोदय ने कहा कि हम इसकी जानकारी जन जन को और भी सुलभ तरीके से बच्चों तक में इस जानकारी को पहुंचाने की चेष्टा लगातार करते थे और करते रहेंगे। अध्यक्षा महोदय ने, सामाजिक विज्ञान के अध्यक्षा महोदय ने इस पे अपनी अनुपम एक जानकारी दी कि झांसी की रानी कंटिंजेंट, उन्होंने एक महिला कंटिंजेंट का फॉर्मेशन किया था जिसमें उन्होंने वुमेन एम्पावरमेंट की भी विश्व को दिखाया था। उस समय इतनी विपरीत परिस्थितियां थी उस समय, उसके बारे में हम वाद विवाद या तरह तरह के विचार आ सकते हैं कि जापानीज ने क्या किया या एक्सिस पावर और एलाइड पावर्स के बीच में हम कहां फंसे थे, लेकिन एक ऐसे व्यक्ति ने, उस महान पुरुष ने, उस माँ भारती के सपूत ने उस समय जो आजाद हिंद फौज का निर्माण किया, गठन किया और लोगों को अपने राष्ट्र पे अभिमान करके अपने जान की कुर्बानी देने के लिए प्रेरित किया, वो अपने आप में अद्भुत था। तुम मुझे खून दो, मैं तुम्हें आजादी दूंगा, इसका नारा देने वाले सुभाष चंद्र बोस जी ने कितनी पीढ़ियों को प्रेरणा दी है और आगे भी देते रहेंगे कि राष्ट्रभक्ति में वो किस प्रकार से हमें अपने जान की परवाह नहीं करनी है, हमें अपने राष्ट्र का झंडा नहीं धुकने देना है और राष्ट्र के निर्माण में या वह उसकी प्रगति में निरंतर लगे रहना है। इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ हम अपने टेक्निकल टीम को भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद देते हैं जिन्होंने सुबह से इस कार्यक्रम को सफल बनाने के लिए अपने अपने राष्ट्र के प्रति अपनी ये श्रद्धा अर्पित की है, और पूरे एनसीईआरटी परिवार को और इस कार्यक्रम से जुड़े हुए संपूर्ण देशभक्तों को भी मैं धन्यवाद देता हूँ। जय हिंद, जय भारत।
धन्यवाद मेजर हर्ष कुमार। और अब इस कार्यक्रम को औपचारिक रूप से समाप्त करने से पहले मैं सभी जो लोग भी इसको जहाँ से भी जुड़े हैं उनसे मैं अनुरोध करूँगा कि वे अपने स्थान पर खड़े होकर राष्ट्रगान गाएं।
जनगण मन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता, पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड कलबंगा, विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्छल जलधि तरंगा, तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे, गाहे तव जय गाथा। जन गण मंगल नायक जय भारत भाग्य विधाता, जय हे जय जय हे जय 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 हे।
कार्यक्रम औपचारिक रूप से समाप्त होता है।